or there'll be joy when the work is done. Joy by and by.
Let us bow our heads for prayer at this time. Our Father God, we come to you with heavy hearts today, asking you to come near at this time. Lord, we don't always understand why you do what you do when you do it. But your word states that your ways are not our ways. Your thoughts are not our thoughts. So God, even though in our grief we submit to your will, knowing that you have it all in control, so we ask you at this time, be what we need right now. Be the comforter that we need. Be the healer that we need. Be the potter that can put broken pieces back together. We ask you, Lord, to be all of who you are at this time. We ask that you will be with the family at this time. Only you know what they're going through. But Lord, you're the only one that can truly do something about it. So God, we're in your hands right now. Do what you do best. That's putting broken pieces back together. So Lord, even in our grief, we submit to your will. We bow to your will. And we look forward into anticipation when we all shall be reunited again. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. At this time, we will have a congregational song, hymn number 440, followed by our three scriptures, Elder Thelma McKenzie, her grandson Benjamin, and her son-in-law, Brother Duran, at this time. If we can have somebody that's going to lead our congregational hymn at this time.
Dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee, yea, I will uphold thee with thy right hand of my righteousness. 13. For I, the Lord thy God, will hold thy right hand, saying unto thee, fear not, I will help thee.
Yahweh, truly I am your servant. I am your servant, the son of your handmaid. You have freed me from my chains. Precious in the sight of Yahweh is the death of his saints.
First Corinthians chapter 15, verses 54 and to 57, and it reads, "So when this corruptible has put on incorruption, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain in the Lord." Amen.
You may be seated. You may be seated. At this time, we are going to have a special song by her grandson. Then we will open up right after this with reflections. The family is asking you to keep your reflections 2 minutes and under. 2 minutes and under.
Good afternoon, church. The song I'll be singing today is Come As You Are by David Crowder, and it's a very, very heartfelt song, and pretty much it tells any person who's hurting, who's in pain, to just come as you are to the Lord, and he'll accept you just as who you are.
Come out of sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let a rescue begin. Come find your mercy, O sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. O wanderer, come home, you're not too far. Lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, come as you are. There's hope for the hopeless and those who have strayed. Come sit at the table, come taste the grace. There's rest for the weary, rest that endures. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't cure. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. O wanderer, come far. So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, come as you are. joy in the morning. Oh, sinner, be still. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face.
At this time, the floor is open for reflections. We are once again asking if you can keep it to 2 minutes and under. Is this yellow mic working? Yeah, all right. So you can just, if you have a reflection, you can make your way right to this mic right here. And
good evening, everybody. To them, I'm here today to speak about my friend. She had me at a very young age, and for some reason, she stuttered very badly. She had a problem with stuttering, so. As a child, being the oldest, I thought that I was a protector. That every time she spoke, that I would finish her conversation. My grandmother, we're from the north of the island, she met her husband in the cul-de-sac valley when they harvested sugarcane way back in the early 60s. So, in the end of the 60s, we moved from the north of the island to more or less the south of the island. Then she met my dad. And then we weren't Seventh-day Adventist Christians back then. But my mom worked at the laundry. Back then it was called Halcyon Days Hotel. She met She met Sister Rachel, and Sister Rachel witnessed to her about the Seventh-day Adventist Christian. My mom went, she read her Bible, and she saw that in the Bible that Saturday was the Sabbath. So she went to the pastor at the Pentecostal church. She said to him, "Do not limit me." She said to him that, "How you said, I see in the Bible that Saturday is the Sabbath. How you never tell us that?" He said, "Yes, Saturday is the Sabbath, but it's not for you to keep." So my mom said, "Well, if Saturday is the Sabbath, how you mean it's not for me to keep?" And he said that the Sabbath was made for man and not man for the Sabbath. So along with Sister Montrose was witnessing to her, my parent. My mom, she was the first one that became converted to the Seventh-day Adventist movement, the message. And then the one day She came home and she said to me, "Oh, Valerie." I said, "Yes." She said, "We won't be eating pork meat anymore." I was happy because I didn't like the pig meat because it was too fat, it was too greasy. So I was happy when she said we won't be eating the pork anymore. So my mom became converted first, but they weren't baptized as yet. So my dad went to his mom, you know, the Roman Catholics, and the mom gave him some pig ears first to cook. So mama, knowing that the pig meat is unclean, she took the pig ears and she threw it away. When my dad came home, he said, he's looking for his meat for him to prepare. He said, "Rebecca, where's my pig meat?" Mama said, "That's unclean, I threw it away." He said, "You threw it away?" He said, no, I want it back." So you know what happened? A fight ensued. So my grandmother, she lived 7 to 8 blocks. So I left the house and she said, "Valerie, go quick, go call Dada." That's my grandmother. She said, "Go call Dada." So I left her. You see me, skinny me, run down the road. When I got, I said, Dada, Mama and Daddy Gary fighting. So then I just turned around and then came back to the house. But I'm just saying, when she did accept the message, she had such a deep conviction that what she knew was not right, she dealt with it and acted upon it right away. And then through the years going, the Christian walk in the beginning was rough. But then with time, the thorns became roses. Amen? It's not like in between that they would not have some thorns, but it became rosier for us than more thorny. And then coming back to this moment, I have not really cried a good cry over my mom. I don't know if I'm in shock or if I'm numb or if we're just still reeling over Esther. But then God is good. Today we are here to celebrate her memory. Good people, my dad, my mom. Good people, and they love people. So I know that had she been here today, she would not have it no other way. She's not concerned about material stuff. You should work to pay your bills. But what she's mostly concerned about is your spiritual life. It's your spiritual life and your education. Okay, but she's mostly concerned that we get our lives together so that if any time that Jesus comes, especially the family members, that we can go to heaven to live with Jesus. I thank you. This is what I have to say about my mom. Thank
you. Praise God again. I want to thank God for Sister Constable, Brother Constable, the Constable family, because it had not been for Brother Constable, I wouldn't be standing here as a Seventh-day Adventist. I've always been a Christian from 85 up until this present time in a Pentecostal church. We became Seventh-day Adventists in 2008. But he would come to my house on Friday night, this little preacher man. I didn't even know his name until we joined the church. But the last night, Brother Baptiste was having a revival at the church in Clewiston, and he came. And I always could hear Sister Constable say, leave them peoples alone. But I wasn't having studied with them. My husband was, which I have a sister. She's a great pastor in the Glades, Henry County area. But he didn't go to church, but he read his Bible. And he would study with Brother Constable every chance he got. But on Friday night, I knew Brother Constable would be there. So I would separate myself and give my husband time with a Christian man. Didn't really know the faith, but I knew it was a God, because he would come and say, "We had a good time tonight studying." Then we went to church the first night we went. The music was not... But anyway, and after the appeal, my husband went to step out, and I said, "I gotta go too." So he said, "What you think?" So I came into the faith, and there's nowhere other place I would be but in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And I thank God for the constables. Thank God for Sister Constable, because she always will hammer on the Sabbath. Sometimes we might say, don't worry them people about the Sabbath, but it's been in my mind that she will say, when you get them, nail the Sabbath onto them. Because they already Christian. They already say they love the Lord. So we gotta let talk. And she will say, let me talk, let me talk. So I'm reading more and I'm studying more, and I thank God for Jesus. Thank God for Brother Constable. You know, and Friday night, every time I would go into the memorial, I couldn't stay in to stand and look at her picture because I'm gonna miss her so much. You know, my mom passed on, but she took it to be my mom, and I love her, and I love you all. So let's continue growing in the Word of God. So let us do what she did. Let's continue standing in her shoes and preaching the Word of God. Amen. So thank you all.
Amen.
Good afternoon. I want to tell the family, look up, have faith, because it's going to get easier. Not right now, but it is going to get easier. Take my word for it. I kind of had to know. I had two children back to back that I lost. And that was devastating to me. But by God's grace and His mercy, I got through. And you know something? I'm going to miss Sister Constable. Every year when mango season comes, she had Brother Constable come to Sister Innocent's house with mango. So I'm going to miss that. And I'm going to try very hard to sing this song. I have heard so much of Jesus. He is a man of Galilee. Oh, how he left his home in glory just to set all sinners free. Oh, I must see Jesus for myself someday. I must see Jesus for myself someday. What about you, church? Are you going to see Jesus?
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
I'm going to tell him all about my troubles as I go down through the years. Oh, I must see Jesus for myself someday.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. I had the privilege of being Sister Constable's pastor for a little under 3 years. And the first thing I noticed about her was the love that she had for her family. Her and Brother Constable, always talking about her children and her grandchildren.
Yes.
And she would go to the ends of the earth for her family. But what was so sweet about Sister Constable is that as soon as you get to know her, she treats you like family.
Amen.
From the day I came, she treated me like one of the family.
Yes, thank you, Jesus.
She was a woman who loved her family, loved others, and loved the Lord.
Amen.
Brother and Sister Constable were faithful, are faithful.
Yes, yes.
Not a day that the church was open were they not there.
Yes.
In my 3 years, if they were in town, not one prayer meeting did they miss. Mm-hmm. Not one church service did they miss.
Yes.
Working in the fear and the love of the Lord.
Yes.
She left a great legacy.
Yes.
For her family. For her friends.
Amen.
For all of us. If we can adopt the life that she lived by, there's no doubt that with her,
yes,
we will see the Lord one day.
Amen. Amen.
God bless you, Brother Constable. God bless you, family. I think we have one more reflection, and after that, two more reflections, and right after the last two, her daughter Natalie will eulogize her in her own special way.
Good afternoon. I live in Miami. Sometime in the early 2000s, I was invited to Cloiston. It was a small rental church, and about that time, at my church, I was going through some things. And I found a home. Many weeks I'll be there on Sabbath morning, Wednesday night, and back on Sunday morning again. And I traveled that 100+ miles for almost 5 years nonstop. One day I asked the Lord, why am I driving this distance? And the answer says, go. I thank the Lord I met this family. And they're not just my church brothers and sisters. They are my family.
Amen.
When I get there, I am welcome as a son who has been away for some time. The love, the fellowship, we will miss the matriarch. We was promised. We have a Father who knows all things.
Amen.
Let us not mourn now, but rejoice. We knew the life that she lived.
Amen.
So now, this time is not for her, it's for you and me.
Amen.
Time to look up. Amen. Our redemption draweth nigh.
Amen.
Amen.
They say that love is an action word. And you know your friends best in your darkest hour. And as I stand here this afternoon, I can say both for Sister Constable. I remember I was probably going through my darkest moments. When I received the call, guess who it was from? Sister Constable. And the first words that came from my mouth is that, I love you. A few weeks later, she met me. And she took me aside. And like a mother, she gave me words of comfort, words of hope. After she was finished speaking with me, I felt like the whole world had just lifted up my shoulder. And she reminded me, as she stuttered many times, she says, my brother, I have a special place in my heart for you. It is usually said that a married man does not talk about another woman in his house. But Sister Andre will tell you that if there is one person's name that has constantly been on my lips, that has been Sister Constable. I will never forget those words. Brother Constable, you had a great wife. Amen. Tabitha, Sister Faye, Sister Natalie, and Valence, you had a great mom. To the grands, to the great grands, to the in-laws, the one who says that you could not have met a better person than Sister Constable. And I know that we all grieve today, and I grieve with you. But we know, thank God, that death is not the end. Amen. There is still life beyond death. So let us live as Sister Constable lived, that someday we will see her in glory. Thank you.
Amen. Good afternoon, everyone. There's my sister. Well, not by mother or father, but she's like a sister to me, Evandrea. Mrs. Agatha Constable, aka Magiri, Sister Constable, died on October 9th at 2:30 p.m. at Palms West Hospital. She was 70 years young and still looking good. I'm sure all of you who knew her would agree. She walked around with a mirror in a purse to prove it. And she always says, I don't like to go to people's house if they don't have mirrors in their house. Growing up, my mom always says, how can you grow up as a woman and not have a mirror in your house? You know, you have to see how your face look, if you have something in your teeth when you live in the house. And she just always said that. She was born in Castries, St. Lucia, November 21, 1945, and her 71st birthday would have been 2 weeks from today. She was married for 43 years to our father, Michael Constable, a.k.a. Brother Gary, Brother Constable, and just a while ago, somebody reminded me, Tigeri, Brother Mark. I heard they said Tigeri. A whole lifetime, she had five children with one daughter, Esther Smith. passing away 4 months ago in St. Lucia from breast cancer. The 4 surviving children, Valence, we have 1 brother who lives in the Tortola, and 3 daughters, Valerie, Tabitha, and Natalie, myself, 12 grandchildren, Emmy being the oldest, and I won't say the favorite, but she thinks she's the favorite, so my mama loved Emmy because she was the first one who came along. And Junior, she loved all her grandchildren, Love and Candy, Samira and Titus, Nick, Shante and Vance, Shania, Val, Ifyok and Benjamin, 3 great-grandchildren, Corel, Rylene, and Aaron, and her sister, Alberta, Wheelie in St. Croix, USVI, and Alberta's children are here today on behalf of their family, and Cecilia Baptiste of Angers de Riso, and her brother, Emmanuel Wheelie in St. Lucia, and her uncle, who we always thought was her brother, because they grew up together, Uncle Yuyu, a.k.a. Tallboy, Joseph Noelin, and many family and friends and cousins. And if you did not hear your name, you were considered a dear friend if you knew her. She was a faithful and active member of Clewiston Seventh-day Adventist Church for many years, an original devout member of the lively Agape de Riso SDA Church in St. Lucia from the beginning. Like a church mother, she loved the Lord, and she loved to share his good news with the people she met everywhere, whomever they were. She didn't care about your class or status. She would see a governor or anything, and, "Excuse me, sir, can you take this track?" Okay, and she'd walk away. My mother was not ashamed or afraid to go into any or approach anybody. She was loved by many. She was caring, giving, kind, and strong. She spoke her mind. I never said amen. I'm sure there's more who say amen. Sometimes a little too much. My son said mercy. But that was the way they loved their grandma. Only now we are finding out how many people's lives have been touched and helped by my mom. Most times without my dad's knowledge. That was the way. She wanted no one to know. You know, if she was helping you, whether financially or whatever, you come to her and ask her for something, and she said, I don't have it. And then a few minutes later, she turned around and said, "Vinny, padigiri, me this $100. You know, she said, "Don't tell my father it's $200. You know, she just says that. Because whatever it was, her heart always broke for people. You know, she always said, money is money. You know, and her love for the Lord should, especially after talking to you, she would always encourage you with her famous words, "Stay with the Lord, my dear, stay with the Lord. Or work out your salvation with fear and tremble," okay? She loved her 2 sons-in-law, Prince Sonny Eddie Midiang, is my husband, and she always made sure when she came home, he loved to cook, she'll cook for him, and my husband always says, "How come you don't cook like your mother?" Well, we'll leave it that way. And don't ask for Jacques Durant, Tabitha's husband. She would say, "Nobody cooks for me and serves me food, Brother Jacques, only you." And she said, "People think I like to cook. I don't like to cook. I cook because I have to. I like your food." And my brother-in-law is vegetarian. She says, "You need to open a restaurant, my son." Or she'll say, "You know what? I can be vegetarian around you, Brother Jacques, because you know how to cook food, all kinds of food with good taste. That's how people should cook vegetarian food. Manger avec bon goût." You know, food with good taste. And, you know, she would tell you if your food was not good. When it came to having money, the grandkids will always say, "I think Mama's lying. I think she's rich. She always has money." Whenever we came in, she'd pull us aside and say, "Here's $20 for girl." "No, no, Mommy, no, no." She'd give the kids, "Ali, point, point, take it, take it." You know, and she always says, "Well, you know, the Lord is blessing." And she always tell us, the first thing you do when you get your money is return your tithe. Return your tithe to the Lord. And my mother, no matter how little she had, we grew up knowing that she would first put aside some money, she and my dad, for the tithe. Where it'd be $20, she put it aside. And we grew up seeing her doing that way. And she never lacked. You know, she would always have something. And my son, who sang, he says, "I think one of these days when Mama dies, we'll go under the mattress and find tons of money." Maybe she's rich, just pretending. But anyway, she has been to the rescue of all of us in the family, financially, and other families as well. If she had it and you needed it, she'd give it to you. If she said no, she would not be able to sleep that night, and she'll call you and figure out a way to do it for you the next day. From St. Lucia, my mom, Agatha Constable, wife of my dad, Michael Constable, she was the backbone and matriarch of the family. Her love and unselfish devotion to us, with the help and guidance of our loving Heavenly Father, has made us who we are and are still becoming every day. She did the best she could and knew how to take care of her family. Her words of wisdom and encouragement will not and should not be forgotten. Her church family, her friends, neighbors, and here and in St. Lucia will miss her very much. Her ultimate desire and prayers were always to see her entire family, her children, her great-grandchildren, her grandchildren, serving the Lord faithfully. She would say, "I don't need your money. I just want you to serve the Lord. That's all I want." That will make me very happy. We all want to make her happy, because I am sure she'll be so happy to see all her family in heaven with her in the sea of glass, the streets of gold. What a day that will be. It should be one of her favorite songs. And she always says, "Just remember, take care of Gary," which is my dad. She always says, "If anything happens, take care of my dad." And I think she knew that if anything happens to her, we'll always take care of our dad. I want to thank everyone for supporting our family. During this time of stretching and growing, learning and reflecting, encouraging and grieving, and then saying, "See you later," not goodbye, but "See you later." Remember who she was: strong, resilient, loving, caring, giving, and sold out to God. May she rest in God's perfect peace until we see her and our sister Esther. Our sister Esther, who face again. We love you, Mommy, and we'll miss you. Mama, Sister Gay, Sister Constable, Rebecca, I'd love to leave you with her famous words of wisdom to practice in our daily living and to comfort your heart. She would say, "Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling." Love you, and stay with the Lord, my dear. And thank you very much for coming.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Valens John. You know, if medals are being given for good deeds that mothers have done, I think my mom deserves everyone. When the news came to me and said, "Bro, Mommy stopped breathing," I was on a rooftop. I know it wasn't easy for me, but every time it came down, I sat down by the beach for a while. Songwriter says, "A motherless child shall find it hard when the mother is gone."
Yes.
Daddy can do all that he can, but daddy could never do what a mother's can. I'm missing my mom dearly. You know, my role model. I always remember that, what she says to me whenever I travel. whenever I go to church. Whenever I talk to other young people or the brethren of the church, I always say to them, Mommy always asks me the question, why you don't join those guys out there selling drugs? Why are you not out there doing marijuana like all the rest of the guys? What really propelled you to stay in the Seventh-day Adventist Church? Well, my simple answer was, you know, I have made reading my hobby. And through reading, not just Bible and spiritual prophecy, health, I have learned how God has dealt with men in time past, and how it is for my example, and I decided to make that my lifestyle. So I said, Mommy, no matter who it is, who come before me, whether it's drug or whatever it is, what present for money, there's nothing in the world that deserves more than my salvation. And so I try to, by God's grace, to hold fast to God's unchanging hands. I have cried a lot of tears since this happened. And I know it wouldn't stop today, not tomorrow. But for my sisters, although we are part by land and sea, my encouragement to us is, let's try to make our call in the election show, because if there is medals for mothers, for all the goods that they have done, Sister Gary, Sister Rebecca, Mama Gay, Agatha, whatever you know her by, I believe deep down my heart that she deserves all.
Amen. 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 Amen.
At this time, we will have a special song by her daughter, Tabitha, followed by a video tribute. And after the video, we will have the sermonette by Pastor Lyndon Walton.
My mom, good afternoon, everyone. My mom is has been an amazing woman, you know. We bump heads like everybody does. I think that's what makes our relationship so. But you know, my mom, I remember one incident when after being here in the United States, leaving St. Lucia and going to New York. I lived in New York for many years, and my profession was nightclub singer. Coming from an Adventist church and home in St. Lucia, getting to a big city of New York and not really knowing much. And what I chose to do was go to work at 1 o'clock in the morning, singing at nightclubs till 4 a.m. And my mom was not hearing about me that much. And I was always hearing that she and my dad were worried about me, and they'd go downstairs of the church and cry and cry. I knew what I was doing was not what I was supposed to do. But it felt good, it was great, I enjoyed it. But I didn't want to tell my mom because I know the standards that my parents have and they've had and they've set for us. So my mom, one night coming from the club, actually getting ready to go to do a show, and I heard a knock on the door in New York City. And I went downstairs and I'm like, what are you doing there? My mom was at the door. I never see my mom in pants. My mom had a pair of pants, long pants, because it was winter. My mom had never been to the snow. My mom hired somebody. I think she's here, Ricky. My mom hired a lady to come meet Ricky. She hired Ricky, and I think they took a bus. And she was in Florida, and she came to New York to find me. And when I saw my mom, I will never forget that. When I saw my mom, I felt like the prodigal son, that story, but then I was not running, she was running to me. And then I never, that picture, when I came down the steps and I opened the door, I hadn't seen my mom for years. And And she came, and when I saw her there, my mom looked so much older and sad, and I just felt like all of this was because of me, because of all the crying, and she wasn't hearing what was going on in my life, and I wasn't too proud of what I was, well, I was, but I didn't want her to know. And then when she opened the door and I saw my mom, I just broke down. The thing she said, listen, she said, I have a ticket for you. Tomorrow, you're getting on that bus. She didn't ask me. I didn't say no. I didn't. I mean, I just said, okay, fine. Next day, we were on the bus heading down to Florida. Oh, my God. It was a shock because Florida was so slow. But after a while, you know, I tried to get acclimated, and my mom stayed here for about a month to make sure I stayed in Florida. And then she left to go home. I think she and my dad were here, or just my mom. And when my mom left, I'm like, I'm not staying in this place. This place is dead. There's nothing happening here in Florida. So I said, okay, it was my birthday. And I went back. My friend said, you got to come to New York for your birthday, at least for a week. I went to New York. It was supposed to be for 1 week. I stayed for 1 year. Then I heard my mom is coming back up. I was like, oh, my God. My mom is coming back up to Florida because I'm in New York. So before she got to Florida, I came down to Florida. I said, Lord, I need to stay here because my mom is going to keep coming and get me. And I'm telling you, that is just one of the many, many things my mom has just proved to me. And it's an amazing, I mean, we had like, words cannot begin to express. So when I see my mom, so many things go through my mind, of course. She lived a great life. She loved the Lord. She was one of my biggest fans when I sing. Wherever I go, when there's, you have to sing, you have to sing. I said, Mother, I'm not your, you have to sing, you have to sing. So I tried to sit at the back. You singing. I said, no, I'm not singing. You singing. So I'll sit up. So there's many songs that she loves. So I'll try to sing this song for my mom. As you can tell, my voice is like totally gone because of all the stuff that's been going on. But I know she can't hear it, but with her memory, I'm going to sing a song that reminds us all that this is literally just dress rehearsal. That this place, this is not where we are going to end up. And no matter how many times we fall, we get back up again. But you know what? Ultimately, I'm looking forward to see my mom and my sister Esther, just going through this with my sister and my mom. I'm looking forward to see them. Because for this, it will be worth it. And for this reason, I pray every day that we live our life with expectancy to see them again. From the throne room of glory, the Father tells the Son, go get my children, for it's time to bring them home. Gabriel, pick up that trumpet, let its throne ring loud and long. I am calling you home. Ooh, this man, he's so lovely, with the scars in his hands. He's serving the table,
communing with friends. Go get a robe and put around him. Place that crown on his head. He's the kingdom, Lord of glory, to all heaven, he said.
Amen, amen. At this time, we have a special video presentation. And then the next voice you will hear is Pastor Lyndon Walton.
My name, title, is Pastor Lyndon Dr. Walton.
So don't speak yet.
After the video.
You want the video first?
Yes.
Oh, sorry.
Of the Lord, I've been
free,
delivered, and in your presence, Lord.
Today,
You've been forgiven.
Forgiven. No more chain.
My past.
My past.
It's over.
It's over. Never going back.
I have brought with me a handful of members of the church that was once Sister Agatha Church. She served the church for a good time as a deaconess. And my wife and I wish to express our sincere bereavement for the loss of this precious soul. If you were to ask me the few words that you could use to describe her, Sister Agatha Constable, I would say that she is a no-nonsense woman. She gives you straight off the shoulder what it is, and yet with a heart full of love. And so, when we say we regret, it is a human language. For God understands why He has called her home. And so, as sorrowful as it might be, from a human standpoint, nevertheless, it is within God's will that He has placed this dear soul to rest. Seventh-day Adventists do not send people to heaven when they die. Amen. Little from this, the cask get here, they will be laid in the heart of the earth. And that is in fulfillment of God's word, that when He takes the breath, then the carcass will return to the what now? The dust. And we look forward with that glorious expectation when Jesus Christ, the life giver, will call Agatha Constable to life again. And we all should be ready to share in that great excitement. We do understand what the family is passing through, the loss of this woman, such a sweet, dear soul of God. But we look forward with great expectation. Wherever the carcass is laid, God will again call her. Yes. I want to challenge you this evening for what lies in this casket is nothing we can do about it. The life was taken by Jesus Christ, God, long ago, some weeks ago, because it belongs to Him. And so we hear, we wish to God it were possible for us to call her to life again. What a rejoicing. And maybe some of you would run out of the church, think it's a ghost. But we are not able to do that. And so I want to challenge you this evening. As mournful as the situation might be, tearful, yes. But I want to challenge you this evening. And I challenge you by asking you a very pertinent question. Why are you here? What brings you here this evening? What business you have come about? Some of you may say, I am here to show my last respect to Agatha Constable. Some of you may say, she is my relative, and this is the last time I will see her. Others may say, she was my good friend for a number of years, and I would be inexcusable not to come to see the last of her. All of these reasons are noble, and they are very gracious for coming to see her for the last time. But unconsciously, you have come to witness the end result of sin. What you have come here today is to witness the end result of sin. Over the years, our lives have read and heard, we have read and heard of the tragedy of sin. But when one comes to a funeral service, he comes to see the reality of sin. This is what sin is all about. For the Bible says, and it teaches well, that the sinner or the soul that sinneth, it shall die. That's the end result of sin. Death. And then in New Testament, Romans chapter 6, verse 23, it tells us every one of us who is a sinner, and there is no one here this evening who can raise his hands and say, thank God I am not a sinner. So all of us are sinners, and we are working for a salary. For Romans chapter 6 and verse 23 tells us the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. But the question that steers us in the face this afternoon, the question is, what is sin? Mankind over the years has tried to give a definition for sin. Some say there is no sin, nothing by the name of sin. And some say sin is just a slip of the tongue. And others say sin is just a mistake. But the Word of God gives the only true definition of sin. You want to know what is sin? Turn to 1 John chapter 3 and verse 4. And it will tell you that whosoever committed sin transgresseth also the law. For sin is a transgression of the law. And so the reason why we are sinners and we are working for a salary which will bring wages, death, is because we are transgressing God's law. Yeah. When God created man, he also gave man a law to teach man the requirements of God and how God wants man to be obedient and to live for him. God with his own finger, because the law of God was so important, this piece of document written upon two tables of stone was so important to God that he would not allow Moses or any of the prophets to write the law with his own fingers. He wrote the Ten Commandments upon two tables of stone. It is found in Exodus chapter 31 and verse 18. And we read, "And he gave unto Moses, when he had made an end of communing with him upon Mount Sinai, two tables of testimony, tables of stone, written with the finger of God." That is so important. How important God's Ten Commandments was, that he could not trust anyone to write it. With his own fingers, I repeat, he wrote it upon two tables of stone. Since the time of writing the Ten Commandments, it has recorded nowhere in the Bible where God has made any change. And if someone is able to bring forth some text to change where God made a change, I would be privileged to have that change. For it is recorded in Malachi chapter 3 and verse 6, "For I am the Lord, I change not." And Psalm 119 and verse 89, "Forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven, and I will not break nor alter anything that is gone out of my lips." Man is, God is not like man. He does not have to change. Over the period of time, whatever God says, God means it, and he stays by it. And therefore, when he invited Moses to come up on the mountain and to bring with him two tables of stone, and he wrote the Ten Commandments on these two tables of stone, Jesus did not have Alzheimer's. God doesn't have Alzheimer's, that he forget and he wants to make a change, or something is better. Jesus, when he came to earth, as he stepped out in the history of man, he made a confirmation. And it is written in Matthew chapter 5, verses 17 to 19. "Think not that I am come to" what? "To change the law." I am not come to change the Ten Commandments. "For it is easier for heaven and earth to pass out of existence than one dot that you put over I and a little tittle that you cross your T, not even that small, would be changed." So then, don't you get the idea in your mind that my coming to earth is to change the law? I am not come to change the law. I simply come to fill up the law. For heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will not pass. And then he makes a very serious statement in verse 11. "And whosoever therefore shall break and teach men to break, that one shall be called the least in my kingdom." There is no place for him. But for many centuries and millennia, man has attempted to change God's law. Yes, that's why church doors are open today. It should have been closed. In Matthew chapter 15, verses 1 to 3, men have changed God's Ten Commandments, and in its place it has put tradition. Then came Jesus, scribes and Pharisees, which were at Jerusalem, saying, "Why do thy disciples transgress the tradition of the elders? For they not wash their hands, for they wash not their hands when they eat bread." It was the custom in the time of Jesus that when you go to eat bread, you were to wash your hands right up to the elbow. And Jesus and his disciples did not wash their hands. That was the tradition. And so the Pharisees accosted them and said, "Why are you breaking the tradition of the elders? For they are eating bread without washing their hands." And Jesus said, "Oh, I'm so sorry. I didn't mean that. I didn't know that." No. Jesus turned the question back to them. And he says to them, "How is it that you take the tradition of men to break God's commandments?" The Pharisees told Jesus that they were breaking the law of God, the tradition of men. But Jesus says, "You are breaking the law of God with your tradition. Lest you might not know, I am to inform you that is well over 100 years now that Father Enright is a Roman Catholic priest. And the moderator of the Methodist Church. Together they have put $6,000. Enright have produced $1,000. And the moderator of the Methodist Church has put five together, making six. And they say any person who can produce one text or a part of a text to show that the Sabbath was changed from Saturday to Sunday, here is $6,000. And up until now, not one single person has been able to claim that. Yes. So, tradition is why you are worshiping on Sunday. And then they go on to say, "You can't find it because we, the Roman Catholics, are the ones that have instituted Sunday as a day of worship." So you'll never find it in the Word of God. So then, what we are doing here is that we are supporting the tradition of men. And greater than that, we are worshiping the Roman Catholic Church because they're the ones who promote that. Ezekiel chapter 11, 19 and 20. "And I will give them one heart," Jesus Christ says. "And I will put a new spirit within you. And I will take the stony heart out of your flesh. And I will give them a heart of flesh, that they may walk in my statutes, that they may walk and keep my ordinances and do, and they shall be my people." When you do God's statutes, when you keep God's law, you are God's people. Yeah. Seventh-day Adventists didn't say that. It is recorded in God's precious word. Am I reading from a comic book here now? I'm not reading from a comic book. By the way, is there anyone with a Bible here today? I'd love, if not. Ezekiel chapter 20 and verse 20 says, "And hallow my Sabbaths, and they shall be a sign between me and you, that you may know that I am your God." You are able to identify the sailor. You are able to identify the soldier from the sailor because of his what? Uniform. Is that right? Yes. His uniform identifies him, who he is. And so as God looks down on 7 billion people that constitute the world membership, the angel asks him, "God, how you know your people? Because we're all scattered. Some going to supermarket, some going to the store, some going here, some going there. How are you able to identify who is yours?" He says, "Come here. You see that guy who stopped at the bus stop there with his hymnal and Bible in his hand, heading for church on the Sabbath? That's one of mine, you know. It's one of mine. Keeps." So Jesus Christ says that when we keep the Ten Commandments, we are wearing the uniform of identification, and God knows you in a crowd of 7 billion people. So, we look at some traditions that have changed. We look, man and woman, God made man for what? Yes, woman for man. Tradition has changed it to what? Man for man, woman for woman, is that right? Yes. Yeah. And so they change the truth of God into lie and worship the server, the creature, more than the creator who is blessed forever. For this God caused, because we are serving tradition rather than what does set the Lord God in his holy word. God says, "I will cause a delusion to come upon you. Vile affection cause trouble to come upon you." You don't see that even now that they have taken the Ten Commandments on the school. You discover how many shooting and killing going on in the school. You don't say that. And all this, when we reject what God says, we are making it difficult for ourselves. So then, please do not forget that what we have come to witness today, now, is sin, the end of sin. And one of these days, we all who are alive will find ourselves in similar position. But before I sit down, I want to read you a few thoughts. And if you don't have your Bible with you, you must write it down, go home and read it. And don't push it under the rug or put it on the back burner. This is what you must read and ask God to help you to understand it. For one day, you will have to give an account. Matthew chapter 15, verse 19. With all of the ceremony that we perform at our worship, with all of the things we do, Jesus says, "In vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrine the commandments of men." In vain. After you make such an effort, after you do so much to serve God, If you're not serving God the right way, God say you are serving me in vain. For you must serve me. If you keep not the commandments of God, you are serving me in vain. And then Isaiah chapter 8 verse 20. To the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to the word of the law of God, there is no light in them. Jesus, when he steps out in the history of mankind, he says, I am the light of the what? And so if you are not be obedient to God's law, there is no light in you. James chapter 2 verse 10. But whosoever shall keep the whole law and offend in one point is guilty of all. If I were to cut a chandelier that has 10 links, how many links would I have to cut for the chandelier to fall to the ground? One. One. And this is what God says. I have given you 10 commandments. If you break one, you are guilty of all. And so you may say, look at me, I am Mistress John, and I try to live up a decent life in my community. Everybody pass by and tip their hats at me and say, Mrs. John, in respect of me, because they know that I am a moral person. And the other man might say, well, I don't steal anymore. And so you don't have, you just have to keep one. And then when the Lord says that when you don't commit adultery, but you steal, you are guilty of adultery just the same. So, God expects us to keep all of his commandments. Then, here is this text. It is found in 1 John chapter 2 and verse 4. He that said that I know him and keepeth not his commandments, you are a liar. Amen. And the truth is not in you. 1 John chapter 2 verse 4. He that said I know Jesus, but you don't keep his commandments, you are just lying. You don't know Jesus. Well, the general feeling about everybody is that when we all get to heaven, that's what we sing. What a day of rejoicing it's going to be. But I'm telling you that heaven is not open for everybody. For Isaiah chapter 66 and verse 23 tells me that from one new moon to another and from one Sabbath to another, all flesh shall come and worship before me, said the Seventh-day Adventist Church. You're wrong, said the Lord. So then, you want to be, it's only one day of worship will be in heaven. One commandment will be in heaven. 10 commandments. You want to go to heaven? You want, when your time comes and you find yourself in a box like this, and you want to have hope of seeing Jesus Christ, you have got to keep God's commandments. For Revelation chapter 22 verse 14 tells me that he that keepeth the commandments of God have the right to the tree of life. I have my keys in my pocket here to my house. Who can stop me from going into my house? Do I not have the right? I can push my key, turn the door, and I enter. And Jesus Christ says, you have no right to enter my kingdom unless you are a commandment keeper. Then, closing text. Jeremiah chapter 6 and verse 16. And then it says, if you want to read, it says, stand in the way. You are confused? Some people go to church on Wednesdays. Some go on Fridays. Some go on Saturdays. Some go on Sunday. You are confused. I want to do the right, but I don't know what is right. I don't know which one is right. Jeremiah chapter 6 and verse 16 says, you come to a crossroad in your life. It's a crossroads in your life. You want to step off in the right direction, but you are confused. You don't know. Jeremiah says, stand. Stand up. Don't move off because your mother was, because your grandmother was, because your grandfather was. Stand up in the way. Stand at the crossroads and ask for the true way. And when you have found it, you are to walk in it. May God help you that you will understand. One day, you are going to be, all of us, for it's a sentence we have brought on ourselves. One day, we will be in this box like a gutter. And then we will have a hope of eternal life. But if you have not lived a life pertaining to God's true commandments, if you have not been obedient to God, then, you know, after Cain's sin killed his brother, came to God with a frowned face. And God said, wait, what's going on? What kind of countenance is this? And Jesus said, God says, you don't need to wear this countenance. You have done the act, you kill your brother. And therefore, if you have done right, then all is well. But if you have done wrong, then sin lieth at your door. So then, before you die, make sure that you are obedient to God's Ten Commandments. Amen. So that you may enter into the gates. I challenge you today at this funeral, go home and check yourself and see what is the relationship you have with God and His law that He has given us to guide us, to lead us in the path of righteousness, and ask God to help you to do what is right, because when that day comes, you want to have the assurance of eternal life.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
I'm going to entreat us to all stand at this time as I give the closing prayer. If you can pray, if you can stand, I'm going to ask you to while we pray. Let us pray. Our God and our Father, we come to you today, for no other help we have but thee. We come today with more questions than answers. But we know that you are the answer to all of our questionings. Lord, we all ask why. But Lord, today we come because we know that there is hope. In spite of the moment, in spite of the grief, in spite of the pain, we know that better days are coming. Our hearts may be troubled now, but Father, you have left us with these comforting words. Let not your heart be troubled.
Because you have gone on that, you are coming back again. To receive us unto yourselves, that where you are, there we may be also. Lord, I want to lift the entire Constable family to you at this time. Lord, I know their hearts are broken. But Lord, I know that you are good at mending broken hearts. Their hearts are sorrowful. But Lord, I know today that you can give comfort. You can give today the peace that passeth all understanding. And as they grieve and as they cry and as they hurt, oh Father, now I ask that, Lord, that you would wrap them in the umbrella of your hands. Speak a word of comfort. Speak a word of love and help them to know that in their darkest hour, Lord, that you would be the rod and staff that would comfort them. Oh Lord, be with them night and day. Give them, Lord, the faith to believe, Father, that you never make a mistake. And Lord, that even in this moment, oh God, that they would hold on even stronger in you. Oh Lord, help them to know that it is not goodbye for Sister Constable. For Lord, there is life beyond the grave. And Lord, she have lived a life knowing that someday when the world is colored yonder, when the skies are rolled back as a scroll and Jesus comes forth, that she would hear her name loud and clear. Those of us who are living, Father, help us to realize that someday that our day will come. So teach us this evening to number our days and apply our hearts unto wisdom and to seek our own soul salvation with fear and trembling. Even in this moment, Lord, we give you thanks and praise. As we think of the uncertainty of life, that death comes unexpectedly and death comes a sudden without warning. Help us today to learn that as the world turns, teach us, Lord, that we have one life to live. So may we find ourselves today in the church of God that's like a general hospital. It will make us bold and beautiful. And Lord, it will prepare us for another world beyond the sunset beach. When all of us, the living and the dead who have lived for Christ, will hear you say that you are all my children. Yes. So Lord, with this in mind, oh God, help us to comfort each other. Again, Lord, I give Brother Constable and the kids and the grandkids and Lord, the entire family into your hands now. Take them, Lord, now. And just give them comfort. Give them peace. Give them your love. And Lord, on that great day when the trumpet shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, followed by the living righteous. But may we all go to live the sisters' ages of eternity, we pray. And we ask it this evening in the name But in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, amen. Let the church say, amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. At this time, we will sing a congregational hymn, hymn number 65, as they come. But after that, we will wait for directions from the funeral director to how to proceed at the end of this program.
God be with you till we meet again.
Be with you till we meet again. By his constant God uphold you. With his strength fold you. God be with you till we meet again. Till we meet, till we meet. Till we meet at Jesus' feet. Till we meet, till we meet. God be with you till we meet again. God be with you till we meet again. Need his wing protecting guide you. Daily manna still provide you. God be with you till we meet again. Till we meet, till we meet. Till we meet at Jesus' feet. Till we meet, till we meet. God be with you till we meet again. God be with you till we meet again. When last parents sing around you, put his arms unfailing round you. God be with you till we meet again. Till we meet, till we meet. Till we meet at Jesus' feet. Till we meet, till we meet. God be with you till we meet again. God be with you till we meet again. Keep love's banner floating o'er you. Smite that threatening wave before you. God be with you till we meet again. Till we meet, till we meet. Till we meet at Jesus' feet. Till we meet, till we meet. God be with you till we meet again.
Let the church say amen. We are Walden Professional Funeral Home, located in the beautiful city of Sanford. We are your only Seventh-day Adventist funeral home in the entire state of Florida. and Christy Walden is our funeral director in charge. As Earth history is winding up, Jesus is coming soon. And God has told us in his word that his children are precious to him even in death. And this is why I know God has put us in this ministry at this time to take care of his children that he has allowed to fall asleep in Jesus. So we are Walden Professional Funeral and Cremation Services, compassionately serving all families with integrity, dignity, and respect. At this time, we're going to do a special presentation to the family.
I am free. Praise the Lord. I'm free. I'm no longer bound. There are no more chains holding me. My soul is resting. It's just a blessing. Before we get ready to exit, I just want to take the opportunity on behalf of the family to say thank you to all the family and the friends for the love and the support you have shown this family. I am sure they will thank you at a later date. And to the family, we thank you for entrusting your wife and your mom into our care. May God continue to be with you all. At this time, we're going to allow you to pay your final respects. We will usher you from the rear of the church to the front. At the end, we will give the family time of their own. Once the last person has viewed, that will conclude our service. May God bless you all.
When peace. like a river attended my way. When sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well with my soul.
Nah. So let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of Him in glory will our toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that we'll sing and shout. We'll sing and shout the victory. I'm so glad that Jesus lifted me. Well, I'm so glad that my Jesus lifted me.
Once you have finished viewing, the family will receive you over in the gym for the repast.
Singing glory, hallelujah, I'm singing. Jesus lifted me. Well, Satan had me bound, but my Jesus lifted me. Oh, Satan.